One of the questions I get asked constantly is, how do I use a chatbot or live chat to engage with a brand new visitor on my website? Well, that's what we're talking about today here on Conversational Growth. Hey there, my name is Brian Bagdasarian, and I am the Conversational Growth Strategist and Principal Inbound Professor for all things conversational here at HubSpot Academy. And like I said, today we're talking about how to start a conversation with a brand new visitor on your website using a chatbot or live chat. Before we get too far along, go ahead and hit that subscribe button right down below. Also, don't forget to give me a thumbs up if you're enjoying this so far, or a thumbs down if you're not. Either one's okay, but I hope it's a thumbs up. Also, down in the comments below, I want to know from you how you're using chatbots and live chat on your website right now. Go down below, tell me what's working or what hasn't, and I'll respond if you have a question and that kind of thing. But let's get going. How do you engage with a new visitor on your website conversationally? Well, there's four pieces to this we're going to cover today. In those four, you want to make sure that while you don't have to do it exactly how I'm telling you to do it, you are aware that these four things are pretty much a proven method of success in making people feel comfortable in engaging in chat, either via live chat or a chatbot on your website. And that's what we want to be doing. We want to get people engaging with us conversationally. You know, one of the things when I first started doing all of this conversational stuff that I made a mistake on, which was something that I just had to learn, is I thought that I could be really salesy. You know, hey, Tim, come talk to me on my live chat. And that just doesn't work. People don't want to feel like they're just being hit by a salesperson the second that somebody comes on the website. It's sort of like if you've ever walked into a store and the minute you walk in, that salesperson is like just on you all of a sudden. They say, hey, can I help you? And you're like, no, man. No, I'm cool. I'm just looking around, because you're not ready to engage. Now, when you might have a question eventually, then you might go find somebody because you need some help. Well, what we want to do is we want to try to create the second part of that feeling that can help the person, make them feel more comfortable, and not make them feel like they're just being attacked the second that they come on your website trying to get something from them. No one wants to feel like they're being demanded to give information. They just want to feel comforted by knowing that somebody is there and can help them when and if they need it. And we'll talk about that in a second, but let's get going here. So the first thing we got to do is we got to just say hi. But we gotta make sure that you say hello in a way that's on brand. You need to make sure that when you reach out, that the way that your chatbot or your live chat operator has been trained is to be speaking in the brand voice. We want to create a brand persona, kind of like a buyer persona, but the other way around. Instead of looking at who you want to attract, you want to be looking at who they're going to be engaging with. And make sure that brand persona and its associated brand voice is on target with what your brand actually is. If you sell, you know, fluffy pillows, make sure that your brand voice sounds like someone who would be really cool with selling fluffy pillows. If you sell, you know, Civil War reenacting, make sure that you sound like you would be really into Civil War reenacting. Hello there, sir. You want to buy a leather hat and reenact a battle that already happened? Because you want the passion that you have for your business to come through in your brand voice in live chat and on chatbots. So the first thing again is just say hi, greet the person when they come in, but do it in a way that's friendly and that maybe even can capture their first name. You can give the chatbot, or obviously the live chat operator is going to have a first name, but you can give the chatbot a first name and they can introduce themselves and say who they are. Don't try to fool somebody, by the way, if the thing that they're chatting with is a chatbot. Don't try to fool them. You don't have to come out and be like, I'm Skippy Bot. But don't try to fool them, because they will figure it out pretty fast, and then they're gonna feel like you were trying to not necessarily be honest with them, and that will probably leave a bad taste in their mouth. Obviously, if it's live chat operator, you don't have that issue, but you want to make sure that you have consistency in how that person has been trained to engage in these live chats with people. And again, they are putting across the brand voice, not their own voice. So it's something to be aware of, that even in something as simple as greeting somebody and saying, saying hi or hello, you want to make sure that you are really sticking to how your brand would be saying that, because the relationship you're building is with your brand and that visitor to your website, not necessarily the person behind it and the visitor to the website. So keep that in mind, but saying hi and saying hello, maybe collecting a little bit of information, is the first thing you want to be doing when you try to engage with somebody via live chat or via chatbots collectively, conversationally on your website. So after you have said hello, you want to make sure that you are able to have them feel comfortable in asking questions. Now let's look at this again through both lenses. With a live chat operator, after they've said hello, they've introduced themselves, they're on brand with the brand voice, you need to make sure that you know what questions are able to be answered by that person and what questions are going to need to move to somebody else. And we'll get to that in a second. If somebody asks a common question, and the way you can figure out what these common questions are, I'm going to give you a little hint. Go ask the people that are having these conversations already. What questions are they being asked all the time? How are they being asked? And then go and find the answers so you can standardize those answers. Now, in a chatbot, it works very much the same way, except instead of teaching a person how to answer these, you're gonna teach the chatbot how to answer these questions. You do wanna be a little bit more prescriptive, a little bit more proactive when you're doing this. You may use things like quick replies or in that welcome message, say, here are the things I can help you with, otherwise, click this and I can get you to the right person. And again, we'll get to that little tidbit in a few minutes. Be more prescriptive with a chatbot so you can guide that conversation, because obviously the chatbot is not gonna have the same ability to reason over what somebody has said that the way that a live person is going to. But the upside of the chatbot is it doesn't require anybody to be actually spending time having those initial conversations, which is going to save you time and, in the end, probably money. Because while the best live chat operators out there can handle 6 conversations at once, a chatbot can handle 6,000 at once if need be. So if you do the math, there's an economies of scale there. It takes a little bit longer to develop that chatbot, but once it's developed, it's going to be very consistent and very clear in how it handles those first conversations, but at the same time, not require anybody to be involved in having them until we get to that thing I keep on hinting at, what happens when they need more help. So that's the second thing, is we want to make sure that we are welcoming them, but we feel to make them feel like they can ask questions when needed, and that we can then go into the third thing here, which is going to be answering those questions. So before we get into the answering of questions, here's what I want to know. How are you going to discover what questions are being asked all the time in your business? My recommendation to you is this. I would go and I would ask if someone, whoever is using your live chat right now. Other thing you can do is look at your chatbot transcripts or your live chat transcripts. They should be available depending on what tool you use. They should be able to be seen. Go tell me down below in the comments how you're doing this. And if you need help figuring it out, let me know what tool you're using and what you're trying to figure out, and I can probably give you a hint in the right direction. Go ahead and leave those down in the comments right now, and we'll get on to the third part here, which is answering questions. So after somebody has asked a question, we want to make sure we can answer the questions. Now again, live chat operators and chatbots, not that dissimilar in how they're going to interact, but what we do want to make sure is that the live chat operators know where to find the information and the chatbot has the information already in it. Now, one of the big things that you have to be aware of is how a question is being asked. Down below in the description, I will put a link to my Fundamentals of Conversational Growth Strategy track over at HubSpot Academy, where you will see there's an entire section where I go over the 8 different types of questions that someone could ask and the answers that they have associated with them. So make sure you check that out if you want to know more about what I'm about to tell you. There are 8 different ways people can ask questions. First off, we have who questions. Who questions are not made by an owl, but in fact, they are looking for a person or team as part of the answer. If somebody said, who do I speak to about this broken widget? They would want to know the person or team they would have to speak to. What questions are looking for factual type answers? For instance, if somebody said, what is the airspeed velocity of an unladen swallow, for all of you Monty Python fans out there, of course, there's a follow-up question. According to the movie, it is it African or European? Either way, it is 37 miles an hour. hour, according to Wikipedia. It's a factual answer. Where questions have location-based answers. Now, there's two types of locations. There are geographic. That means that they can be found on a map. Like, where are you located? You can tell them the address and probably even the GPS coordinates of that location. But if somebody said, where's the reset button on my computer? They don't care about where the computer itself is. They want to know where that button is based upon the computer itself. It might be on the back or the front or wherever. Point is it's not found on a map, it's found on an object. When questions involve time as part of the answer. Now there's two types again here, one of which is an exact, for instance, what time do you open? We open at 9 a.m. Monday through Friday. Or it could be relative. When should I expect my package to arrive? It'll arrive within 2 to 4 days. That's a relative type answer because it doesn't give an exact time or day of arrival. Now, of course, if you use Amazon, you know that they'll tell you pretty much down to the minute, but that doesn't always work out. So relative type time answers are what we use when we can't give an exact answer. Why questions are looking for reasoned explanations. Now, what is a reasoned explanation? Well, a reasoned explanation means that there's actually the thought behind why something is occurring. Somebody said, why is the sky blue? It's not just because it is, you know, that's not the right answer. In fact, it has to do something with how the light reflects through the atmosphere and this, that, and the other. Look, I'm not gonna put it down in the description, you can Google that, but there is a reason for it, and that is why you would look that up, because it has the reasoning behind it as the answer itself. How questions are looking for the descriptive manner as part of the answer. Usually there are some steps involved as well. For instance, if somebody asked you, how do I return an item? You might have a few steps. The first step might be fill out this form. Second might be get a return authorization number. Third would be to send the package back in, and fourth would be that they would have to review it at the warehouse once they've received it. Those steps would be involved with how they go through the return process. Which questions are selector questions? It means that you're working off of a set of possible answers. If somebody was looking at shirts and there was small, medium, large, and extra large, they'd be looking for which one of those would fit them. Which one of these shirts would fit me best? Of course, you would look at that, unless you're me and you're 6'4", 300 and some odd pounds, and nothing ever fits you. Finally, we have yes-no questions. Yes-no questions are things like can I, will I, should I, or do I? Of course, there are other ones out there, but all of them have fundamentally the same type answer. Yes, you can, or no, you can't. Yes, you will, or no, you won't. Yes-no questions are often followed up with the reason behind that answer, but they are very binary, which means they only have two options as their possible answer. And that's it. Those are the types of questions. Let's get back to what we were talking about. Big thing here is you want to make sure you have the answers available for the types of questions you're going to be getting. This does require a little bit of planning because each one of those types of questions has a specific type of answer that is going to be expected. So make sure that you've done that planning, you have figured out how to answer the questions that you're allowing to be asked, and that's going to bring us to our fourth thing, which is what to do when you can't answer the question or it's outside of the scope of your live chat operator or your chatbot. So what do you do when somebody isn't able to provide the answer? When that live chat operator doesn't know the answer, or if the chatbot doesn't have the answer programmed into it? Well, this is where that thing I've been hinting a lot the entire time of this video, we need to be able to escalate the conversation. Now, there's a few different ways we'd want to do this. Imagine if somebody is coming across as a really hot lead. They're saying all the right things in the conversation and they want to know more. Why make that person wait? You can escalate that conversation to a salesperson. You can transfer it over to a salesperson, and you've already collected all that information. It's in your CRM, so that salesperson can go and speak to them right away, and you don't have to cause a delay in that person getting what they want, and the salesperson might even get a sale. But on the other side of it, what if they need to speak to you or speak to somebody in the company about something that is not covered in this first level of conversation, either live chat or chatbot? This is where the more traditional way of escalation comes into play. You want to make sure that when somebody needs something that you have not set as this first level of conversation, that they can be transferred to somebody that can help them. This doesn't necessarily have to be somebody sitting around waiting. We all have lives, right? We all have other things we're doing. So we want to make sure that we're able to just be really clear that if the person they need to speak to isn't available, telling them when that person will be available. Hey, they'll get back to you by the end of the day. They'll get back to you in 24 hours. whatever it may be, it's actually a really easy way to collect more information, because it's really normal to say, hey, listen, the person you need to speak to isn't available right now. Let me get your name and email, and I will make sure that they get back to you within 24 hours. All of a sudden, you create a lead there that you can follow up on. Now, if that person is available that they need to be speaking to and transferred over to, that's great as well. It's a simple handoff. It's just something as simple as, hey, let me just get that person for you, and then bang, within 30 seconds, they're transferred over. Here's what you don't want to do. What you don't want to do is make that person that is chatting with you all of a sudden wait because you go silent for 5 minutes. If for some reason you cannot transfer over immediately, it's better to tell that person that it's gonna be either A, a few minutes, or B, that someone will reach out to them via email, for instance, and get in touch with them. And that email can actually be automated. This is something that's amazing and can be done with HubSpot conversations and with the HubSpot tools, is you could actually have then that person subscribe to a workflow. That workflow could then trigger an email. That email will send off. It'll have in it a link that brings them back in and triggers the follow-up conversation when that person is available. Down below in the comments, if you want to know how to do that, you want me to make that tutorial, let me know. If you want to see how you can actually use workflows, HubSpot conversations, and an email sequence to collect lead information, trigger off the workflow, send the email, have the email then bring them back to, let's say, a new landing page, and then continue that conversation, I'll do that tutorial. But you have to let me know down in the comments that you want to see it. Big thing here, big takeaway. Escalation. You want to make sure that you can get the person to the person or resource that they need, and if they're not immediately available, that you are just super, super straightforward with that. Make sure that you are never making them wait too long, and you're just saying, hey, listen, we got to wait for a few minutes, or hey, this person will be in touch with you. Either one is totally cool. You just gotta be clear about it. That's the big thing. You've just gotta be really straightforward. So to recap, the four things you wanna be doing when you're getting somebody to engage with you conversationally on your website and they're a brand new visitor. One, you wanna greet them on brand in a brand voice. So make sure that with the way that you say hello or hi and what you say initially sounds like what your brand would be. Two, make sure that you make it clear that they can ask certain questions and expect the answers accordingly. Three, make sure those answers are available. And four, make sure that you can escalate that conversation to somebody that can help them if that chatbot or first level live chat operator can't. That's all for now. If you have questions, comments, or concerns, leave them down below in the comments. I'll add some links there as well in order to know what we've talked about today, and the resources I've mentioned will all be available for you. But other than that, go out, think conversationally, start building some great chatbots, and engage with people on a one-to-one basis, because we're going to teach you how to do it at scale here at HubSpot Academy. That's all for now. Go ahead and hit that subscribe button to know when new videos come out. Follow me on Twitter and Instagram. It's at RealBrianBags. To know more about HubSpot Academy, click this link right here to watch the next video. That link right there. Leave your questions and comments down below. Go build chatbots, think conversationally, and we'll talk soon.